Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to another Color of Science show. Let me share my screen. All right. So this is Color of Science Digital Edition. It is brought to you by CoSci Connects Live. First of all, a shout out to both Vanessa Bowers and Jordan Radar, who have helped bring this program alive. We have an incredible special interview for you all today. Before I get to our amazing guests, I gotta give a shout out and acknowledgements to the organizations who help provide extraordinary support to bring this program on. First of all, the presenting sponsors, Battelle and L Brands, the lead funder, the Curtis T and Beverly Cheeks Jewel Family Fund, and event planner, Gramercy Bookstores. And this event partner, this is really special. This is the first time we've done this. We've had Kathy Sullivan, we've had Caleb Anderson, we've had rock stars on the show, but this is the very first time we've partnered with a bookstore. And Gramercy Bookstore is the only place where you can get an exclusive signed copy of our guest book called Not Necessarily Rocket Science. More about that soon. Again, you can get the only place you can get these signed copies here, at least in the Greater Columbus area, is at Gramercy Bookstore. There are limited copies available, so make sure you check that out. And then thank you to the additional sponsors that help bring the Color of Science to our community. Look, I'm just gonna jump right into it and introduce today's incredible special guest. It's my honor to be interviewing and having a conversation with Ms. Kellie Gerardi. She's an aerospace and defense professional and popular science communicator. Ms. Gerardi has flown multiple parabolic research campaigns to evaluate commercial spacesuits and conduct bioastronautics. I know a lot of words, man, but I'm going to ask what the heck is bioastronautics, because that's a cool term. Research in microgravity with Project Possum, an acclaimed suborbital research group. Ms. Gerardi's work to promote citizen science and inspire women in STEM has been featured across a broad range of media and has attracted, are you guys ready for this? Thousands of fans on social media. That was a joke. Hundreds of thousands of fans on social media. She's worked with a number of commercial spaceflight companies and government agencies and has led special projects for the Commercial Spaceflight Federation. She now serves on the Defense Council for the Truman National Security Project and is a director of the Explorers Club, whose esteemed flag she carried during a crew rotation at the Mars Desert Research Station. Ms. Gerardi lives in Washington, D.C. area with her husband, Stephen, and their daughter with the best name on the planet, Delta V. Her first book, Not Necessarily Rocket Science. It is not her last book. She may talk about this later, but she is now on the way to launch an incredible children's series, a illustrated, really great book for kiddos all around STEM and SEAM. With that, it's my honor to introduce Ms. Kellie Gerardi. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
You are very welcome. So I'm unsharing my screen. I'm going to jump right into it because you got one of the best resumes, and we'll pull out your story, how you got to where you were. But let's just begin. First things first. What was the first thing that sparked your interest in science as a child?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I've thought about this a lot because, as you know, but other folks might not, I didn't go to school for a STEM degree. You know, when I went to college, I ended up getting a film degree. I've always been interested in communication, right? And I thought about, you know, now living this career and this dream in the aerospace industry, I think back, well, why didn't I go to school for this? And it wasn't for lack of exposure. I grew up in South Florida, actually in a town called Jupiter, Florida, where I'm dialing in from live from Jupiter today. And so it was sort of written in the stars. And not only that, but get this, from my bedroom window, I could actually see the stretch of sky over Cape Canaveral, and I watched shuttle launches growing up. And so I was living in this backdrop of human spaceflight and exploration. And there was yet something that just made me think, it doesn't seem like that's an industry for me. It seems like this is only reserved for just these extraordinary people who knew they were going to be an astronaut from preschool and really like charted course from there. Mm-hmm. And so it was later after school where I met someone whose story really inspired me. And that was a gentleman named Richard Garriott Takayo. He was a famous video game developer, actually. And he became a private astronaut. He was one of the first humans in history to go to the International Space Station as a civilian, as a private astronaut. And it blew my mind. And it made me realize that, you know, perhaps my sort of adolescent space dreams weren't quite over yet. Maybe there's another way to do this. And so that really inspired me to think about, well, how can I get involved?
Well, this is so important, and we're going to unpack this because, you know, all of us have dreams of space flight. We all love the concept of an astronaut going out there in space. But without question, prior to individuals like yourselves and specifically you, you know, most of us think that it's an unattainable dream. Like, I have to go through NASA. I'm going to be, you know, 12 of 7.7 billion people to be luckily selected to do this. And it's just unattainable. So, but go back a little further. It's so important to underscore your education because you are a passionate STEM advocate, a STEAM advocate. You're all about engineering. You probably know about engineering and defense stuff more than the lion's share of engineers out there. But you have a film degree. And I want to underscore that because, again, whatever your passion is, to the listeners out there, whatever your passion is, you can study that but still achieve all these other things. So with that, how is navigating, since you have a film degree and you didn't officially have a STEM background, how is navigating the commercial space industry as a non-engineer influence your perception of the importance of STEAM?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's a great topic because people have asked me in the past as well, if I could go back and do it again, would I go get the engineering degree instead and go on a more traditional course here? You know, and my answer is, well, I think that's a very wonderful path for a lot of people who know exactly what they want to do. The answer for me is always no, because I think I was able to create unique and outsized impact from the thing that I was most passionate about. And I came in and added a new perspective to an industry that needed new perspectives. But to answer your question about, you know, the importance of STEAM versus STEM, I wrote an entire book on it, not necessarily rocket science. And in the introduction to that book, I draw comparisons to the Renaissance, where art was only one manifestation of this new way of thinking. And that cultural innovation was also happening across all of these other disciplines like medicine, technology, even religion and politics and philosophy, right? And so I was reflecting that similarly, engineering innovation right now is just one small slice of the space age, but that this too is a broader cultural movement and our next giant leap will require the contributions of artists, engineers, and everyone in between. You know, so this is really something that I think is everyone listening today happens to be alive during this very unique window in history. Not only the first time in 4.5 billion years that humans are capable of, or any life on Earth, I should say, is capable of leaving the planet, but more specifically, that there are more and more access points to space where government space agencies are no longer the only path to space flight.
Yeah, and we're going to get to that, the SpaceX and Virgin Galactic, et cetera. But before we get to that, you do know it was fake, right? I mean, you glossed over it real quick, but film degree or not, little kid growing up before it or not, your street's called Jupiter. You knew that was coming full circle at some point in your life. So very cool. So, all right. So you're in this space, you're conquering it. You know, you talked about the importance of STEAM versus STEM. You wrote a whole book about it. Again, audience, please go and buy her book at Gramercy Bookstore. You'll get a signed copy. It's a great opportunity. And you talk about that STEM, STEAM discipline. And I love how you framed it out. And I'll just add this idea of, you know, sometimes people say, oh, I'm right-brained or left-brained. You know, I'm a math person or I'm a dancer. It's no question you may have your preferences, but we have a full brain. We have both sides. And regardless of if you're a math person or a dancer, we don't see many people walking down the street with half a brain, right? And so I love how you unified that. It's so important and it's so relevant with how we need to move forward. So with that, fast forward to right now, 2020 or last year. 2020 has been a challenging year for Spaceship Earth. Have recent events made you think differently about the responsibility of space industry?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I've thought about this particular kind of train of thought and question a lot in the last year. Many of us have had more time than ever before to reflect. And I think 2020 has really sharpened the lens for a lot of folks. And I think as it relates to space, particularly, you know, the reality is that there is this contrast and emotional dissonance between exhilarating space achievements that are going to keep happening for the next decade. We're going to go further than we've ever gone before and continue. And also devastating earthly happenings in the backdrop of that. And that dissonance and, you know, emotional contrast is only going to continue as this decade unfolds. And I think many of us in the space industry know that space is critical and that this is not mutually exclusive. We can care about more than one thing at the same time, both long-term and short-term. But I think we also need to lean into that and hold ourselves accountable to being agents of change, whether, you know, their societal plagues like bias, both overt and implicit, you know, our industry is not immune, or whether they're literal plagues and pandemics that are, you know, bringing an entire globe to its knees on a public health crisis. You know, these are all things that we need to grapple with. And I think more than ever, we've realized that space exploration, or at the very least human space exploration, will always be intrinsically tied to what is happening to humans on Earth. We are not going to exist separate from society.
So that's a perfect segue to my next question. Before I get to that, again, you're listening to the Color Science Digital Edition. I have my very special guest, Ms. Kellie Gerardi, who is an aerospace, I guess, celebrity at this point, extraordinaire. I'm Frederick Bertley, President CEO of COSI. And I want to pick off where you left off, because you talked about it's important for us on Earth. So to that, you often speak about diversity, equity, and that these aren't just niceties, but they're necessary for success. And obviously, I couldn't agree with you more. This is the Color of Science program, which is all about celebrating women and persons of color in the STEM and STEAM industries. So it's near and dear to my heart, but how would you describe the necessity for diversity and equity specifically in the space industry?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, my background, as you mentioned in the very kind bio, spans both aerospace and defense. And so for me in my career, these have been intertwined. And I think what I've learned over a decade of whiteboards and war rooms is that the people who are designing the technology holds the power to influence how it's applied. And in a high tech and high stakes industry, whether that's aerospace or defense or a combination of the two, it's in everyone's best interest that we're cultivating the broadest possible set of perspectives and approaches to the complex problems of tomorrow. And I think that to me is really distilled what we're talking about when we talk about diversity in these fields. Because when we're talking about space exploration specifically, or space settlement, I think what we're really talking about is the future of the entire human species. And so, you know, the impact of racial and gender inequities become pretty far reaching on that scale. And the stakes are just too high for any single demographic to be steering all of spaceship Earth. And so I think we still have a long way to go, but I have been really encouraged, at least in the last decade that I've been a part of this industry. I have really seen a prioritization of diversity, equity, and inclusion. I think that it's becoming something that our leaders are really rightfully prioritizing and taking accountability for. And I think it's the right move. It's, you know, one of those right thing and smart thing, right? Like if we as an industry want the world's trust and support to open the final frontier for all of humanity, our workforce needs to more fully represent humanity. And so we need to hold our peers and leaders accountable.
I love that, you know, and we talk about this at COSI all the time. You know, the world is roughly 51% female. So if we don't have opportunities for women to get into STEAM fields, we're actually not benefiting from the genius that exists there, right? I mean, genius knows no race, no religion, right? Some people are super talented and gifted and will contribute. And it's the same thing. We have about roughly, you know, certainly half the planet is more than black and brown. We got to make sure those opportunities exist. And so we like to talk about here at COSI, you know, you need to be a technology creator and not just a technology consumer. And I think that speaks to what you're talking about. And so speaking to of democratizing the access to space, how do you think spaceflight candidate profiles and qualifications will evolve? And specifically, let me drill that down a little more. Okay, we know the NASA path, you become an astronaut, fine. We're talking about to the expert who's gonna explain to us all the possible other avenues to potentially achieve spaceflight. So with that as the landscape, whether it's SpaceX, you know, Virgin Galactic, all the other ones that you're gonna share with us, talk to us about the candidate profile. A, back to your power base, who's gonna make those decisions? Is it just, oh, I got a $300,000 check, I can buy it? Who's gonna make the decisions, and what are the profiles and how do the qualifications evolve?
Yeah, absolutely. So this is a moment of incredible opportunity. And I just wanna reiterate what a sort of game-changing point we're at in terms of democratizing access to space. And so just to briefly put it in perspective, right? Think about how many humans in the entire history of the world have ever been to space. We're talking less than 1,000, okay? We're talking like 600 to 700 people ever. Wow. If you think about a company, let's use Virgin Galactic as an example, where they have a suborbital spacecraft that's going to start commercial operations, you can imagine that in the first 2 or 3 years of operation, that one company alone can single-handedly double, triple, quadruple the number of humans who have ever been to space in the history. Mm. So this is, we are flipping the profile of what a space traveler means. What does it mean to be an astronaut? We need new vocabulary. We need a new lens to look at this next chapter through. So it's very exciting just as a backdrop. But when I think about suborbital spaceflight, to your question about candidate profiles, what I think is that this is the great equalizer, because suborbital spaceflight at a lower price point, at a more accessible reality, is going to open the door for researchers like myself, students and scientists, even tourists. Yes, I do believe exploration needs both patrons and pioneers. And so I think it's a really exciting time. But I think the coolest part about this is the competitive commercial aspect works in all of our favor, because baked into a commercial company like Virgin Galactic is the goal of enabling spaceflight to as many potential customers as possible, right? That they can get to experience the wonder of spaceflight. So tossed out from that formula is the really restrictive requirements that have held back hopeful candidates in the past, you know, whether it was eyesight or minor medical problems that totally disqualified someone. Instead, a company like Virgin Galactic can look at spaceflight operations and their medical program with a really diverse health group in mind from the start, right? Different access, different demographics. You know, they're realizing that their passengers are going to have a little bit more of a diverse, maybe colorful medical history than some NASA astronaut candidates. And that represents a step forward or change in qualification and also in access, and competition, of course, continues to drive down the price for people in the market. And so I think this is really an exciting time. I also think that this is going to play out on an international scale too. Of course, America has a very, you know, consistent footprint leading space endeavors. And I do expect that to continue. But what we're going to see through commercial spaceflight opportunities are the ability of nation states who have never had a footprint in space to suddenly send astronaut representatives from nations that have never had that access before or don't have national space programs of their own. I think it's space is something that's disproportionately prioritized around the globe. And this is a really exciting next step.
So that's so a couple of things, dude. I'm super excited. That's so one, to distill it down, all of us theoretically can actually have a chance to go to space if we want.
Absolutely. And I think one of the cool things, just to put in perspective how accessible, at least physically, this is, we can talk later perhaps about the Inspiration 4 mission. There's an intent right now to send a SpaceX all civilian flight to orbit the Earth to raise money for St. Jude's, mm-hmm. a children's cancer charity. But Elon Musk has said basically about who was able to take a ride in the Dragon spacecraft. His comments were basically, look, if you can ride the Hulk roller coaster, you can probably ride the Dragon. And so this is what we're talking about as the comfort level of these space capsules evolve. And as, you know, these new systems are built into place that, you know, all of us can take advantage of at some point in the future.
So listen, kiddos and adults alike who are listening, get your roller coaster game on. No time to be shy anymore in that line. Get in there and get that experience. And I love the piece you mentioned about the international kind of alignment and especially states and nations that didn't traditionally have a space exploration. I mean, you know, look, I'm West Indian. My parents are from the Caribbean. I know there's a Jamaican bobsled team. I can't wait for the Jamaican space team.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what we're looking for, right? It's like, whether it's the first satellite or the first astronaut representative, we're talking, you know, an opportunity for countries to really drive towards their own history-making national firsts.
Yeah, fantastic. Well, look, you're clearly speaking to us. This is the Color Science Digital Edition brought to you by COSI and COSI Connects here in Central Ohio. So clearly we're communicating through this medium, which is awesome. But share a little more about the tools and platforms you use to share out and promote science to a broad audience. And then, of course, touch on social media. But I know you got your book, so that's one medium. You got these new kick butt children's books that are going to be coming out, influencing the next generation of space enthusiasts. Talk to us about what are other modalities you use.
Yeah, absolutely. So I've had the privilege to build a really large science communication platform. And I think social media has really been, you know, my biggest access point to reach people. So Instagram, TikTok, right? I've had the opportunity, as you just mentioned, to also take the conversation onto bookshelves. But I think that social media has really been that catalyst. And I think space is something that's so, you know, to use a space pun, universally interesting to people. And when you're able to sort of show some of the imagery of that, I mean, looking even just behind me at this cardboard cutout from a canceled book tour due to COVID. I have an army of cardboard Kellies around my house that I put to great use all the time on Zoom.
But put those up on Amazon. I'm sure you can get a pretty penny.
But it's like the imagery of space. It evokes something in us. It's something that resonates with a lot of people. And so when I'm able to use my social media platforms to take people on an experience with me, to show what it's like to float in microgravity, what is it like to wear a pressurized spacesuit? You know, all of these things that people may have thought were inaccessible or something that they couldn't participate in. My message is, here's what it looks like, and here's how you can do it too. First, get involved, get inspired by the social media, and then the book is the handbook and the guide to how you can do it yourself.
Yeah, no, terrific, terrific. Those are all great resources. We're gonna make sure we save all this chat for that great commentary. We have some questions coming in on the chat, and we will get to those. But I have a few more questions for Mr. Gerardi, and then we have some questions from kiddos who submitted them earlier in the past 2 weeks. And so I want to ask a few of those before we get to the chat, but we will get to your questions in the chat. So, you know, you may be young, but you're completely extensive in terms of experience. What have been your most rewarding and most challenging career experiences to date?
Start with the challenging first. And I think, you know, for me, it's goes back to the fact that this industry was not an obvious fit for me from the start for multiple reasons. First, you know, coming with a liberal arts background, right? And just a very non-traditional path. And I think from that stemmed this disproportionate sense of pressure, the feeling that I had to work twice as hard to prove my place in this industry, and this feeling of pressure, like if I messed up, suddenly it wasn't just a reflection on me, it was a reflection on all non-engineers in STEM or all women in STEM, even worse. Yeah. And so I think that coupled with, I didn't see a lot of people who looked like me. I really loved fashion and beauty and makeup and things like that. And I remember intentionally toning down those things to hope that people might take me a little bit more seriously. Of course, now looking back, I could kick myself. Right. It's like I embrace my multitudes now and know that that doesn't make me any less capable or credible. But it was something that I struggled with until I really gained more confidence and learned to embrace those multitudes. So that was probably the most challenging piece. The most rewarding piece was, you know, using my social media platforms to work through that vulnerability with other people. I honestly think that is what has helped me build such a strong community online of support. Is I've always showed the ugly sides of things. If I'm going through something, you're gonna hear about it because I use my social media as sort of an outlet. It's the good, the bad, and the struggling in between. And so what I've earned from that is this extraordinary community of people who are willing to share their own vulnerabilities with me. And I think the most rewarding sort of cherry on top has come after the release of my book. I had so many messages and reviews from followers who said things like they've gone back to school for their dream degree, or they've applied for their dream job, or they've started their own science communication platform, and thanking me for helping them, you know, figure out those next steps. And that just means the world.
Wow, that's fantastic. And I really appreciate you celebrating a positive use for social media, because, you know, today, especially with people who have kids, you know, social media is getting and can get a bad rap, et cetera. But at the end of the day, it is a tool. It's a sharper pencil. And you can use that pencil, that sharper pencil, for really productive ways. So I'm glad you underscored that. So I'm just going to, there are questions popping all over. I'm just going to ask one of my last questions and then jump to the kiddo questions, which are my last questions. Can you share a story about a mentor that inspired you? We all talk about mentors. You know, hopefully, you know, people have access to someone who influenced them positively. Give us one or two of your great mentor stories.
Absolutely. So I will do two. So first, the name I had mentioned in the beginning, Richard Garriott Takayo and his wife, Leticia Garriott Takayo, really just my biggest cheerleaders in my career. And I want to just really take a second to distinguish between like what is a mentor and what is a sponsor in a career, because they've acted as both and it's been critical to me progressing in my career. So their mentorship was helping me figure out how to get a foot in the door. It was giving me the advice that I needed to even know what was the first step, which they did. They entertained all of my basic questions. They were very patient with me as I figured out which way was up in the industry. But beyond that, as I earned, you know, their trust and respect together, they became sponsors for me in my career. And what that meant is they weren't just showing me where the door was, they were holding it open for me. They were making connections for me. They were putting their name down as collateral to say, I endorse Kellie. I think she would be a great fit with your organization, you should take a chance on her. And that obviously was incredibly moving to me. And I've made it my explicit intent my whole career to pay it forward, and also to make sure that I lived up to their expectations. So it was critical. The Commercial Space Flight Federation, that introduction came from Richard and Leticia, and that launched my career. Richard was my original sponsor to the Explorers Club. I worked coat check at the Explorers Club before I was a member of the club. Today I'm on the board of directors. It's come full circle. And so it's just, you know, you find people like that who are willing to take bets on you, and it just, you know, is make or break. And two, I'll briefly share a story of a mentor and someone who I was just so privileged to know, who you may have heard of. His name was Professor Stephen Hawking, and he really made an imprint on the world. I'm sure all of you know his name. But it was a joy to know him and to witness, you know, not only his brilliance, but he actually had a great sense of humor and a sense of mischief. And I think, you know, I had just an enormous privilege. I contributed a chapter to his children's book, George and the Blue Moon, which I recommend for young bookshelves. It's amazing. But one just quick personal reflection. I was at his 75th birthday party, and I remember looking around the room of all of these guests, and you know, you had the really esteemed academics who you might expect, but then you also had the film and television stars, and then everyone in between. And just the diversity of his friendships in life just to me summed up a life really well lived. And I just think he left his thumbprint on the entire world, and certainly on my career specifically. And humanity is better off because of him.
Well, look, I mean, we got to explore this a little more, because it's fascinating what you said. So first of all, shout out to Richard and Leticia. Clearly they were amazing. And obviously, you know, Stephen Hawking, for those of you not sure who he is, you know, won a Nobel Prize in physics, wrote a famous book called A Brief History of Time. And it's just, to your point, a phenomenal human being. And I don't know him. I've never met him personally. So to hear you talk about meeting him and seeing that collective of people celebrating his life, not just physicists or not just people who made a movie, but this wide swath is really, really cool. So I want to ask a specific question, because I get this asked a lot. We know mentors are important. You named two that were critical to help you. One thing that I know people struggle with is, how do you find them? So can you talk about how you first met Richard and Leticia, and how did you become part of the Hawking family friend group?
Yeah, absolutely. And so again, it was, you know, for me, it was volunteering my time at the Explorers Club and, you know, really trying to, these were some of the people I respected most in the world. I admired the most. The Explorers Club, just by quick definition, it's a scientific society, but their members are responsible for a famous series of first to the moon, to the North Pole, South Pole, bottom of the ocean, Mount Everest. I mean, really just incredible group of explorers throughout history. And so their headquarters was in New York City. And I decided, you know, once I had this sort of beginning interest in space and exploration, I was like, wow, this is in my backyard in New York City. Let me see how I can get involved just as a beginner to get exposure to this kind of great group of people. And one of those avenues of exposure at the time for me was the ability to volunteer my time with the organization and then to work coat check. Then to be able to, and I did a great job at coat check. I think that's the other thing. It's like it was something that I took pride in doing well. It's like my attitude has always been, there's no job too big or too small. I'm going to treat any task with the same level of execution and follow through. And I think that really helps, you know, distinguish people. People appreciate folks who are giving their all no matter what the task looks like. And so for me, I do believe that there was some amount of luck, right? You know, meeting the right types of people, but I think you can create circumstances where you are more likely to get lucky in life. And that is through some hard work, some dedicated focus, and researching, you know, what are the industries that are most exciting to you? What are the intro opportunities or societies or nonprofits that exist around the periphery of this? I mean, look at COSI, for example, some of the luminaries that you've had come speak at this program. It's like, here's a nexus point right in someone's backyard. It's like, these are all things that, you know, if I were really eager to get involved in the same way, I would be looking at.
Look, I think that's terrific. And I think, you know, you're a model example of how to get role models. I want to summarize them. One, do your research, right? The good news is there's certain things that we can do. Do your research. Two, you got to put yourself out there. You didn't just kind of hear about the Explorers Club. You say, no, I'm going to be a coat check person. And then whatever you're doing, work hard at it. Because you as mentioned, you were probably the most gracious, best coach check person. And guess what? All the guests remembered you, and boom, you made more connections. So getting back to what you said about the luck, I think really that's one of the most important things that I would love for all of our listeners to understand, but especially the younger kids, that you definitely have a role or a chance to make some of your luck and own that and celebrate that. So I want to punt to my questions from the kiddos. Normally they tell me the grades. These ones didn't submit their grades, but I have Slain M who asked, what could I do now to prepare for a job like yours?
Yes. And I'm glad knowing that these are kid questions. I'm like getting Google ready in the background because I have to remind you guys, I have a film degree. So that's always my fallback, but no, it's a great question. So I think, you know, the things that I would recommend that you could do now, and it depends, you know, when you say like a job like yours, I would encourage you to define that for yourself. Like, what does that mean to you? What is the most exciting part of what I do or what I've had the opportunity to be involved with that like stands out to you as I want to do that? If it's testing spacesuits or flying in microgravity, you know, those are wonderful and plentiful opportunities. If it's, I want to be a NASA astronaut specifically, you know, of course that's not me, but that would, I would have a different recommendation for that track because we've seen what's been successful with that profile. But for me, if you want to be involved in the commercial space industry, I would advise you to figure out what your passions are and then follow them. Really gain expertise in the things that stoke your curiosity the most, and then figure out how can I apply those skill sets that I've earned that I now have expertise in through school to the space industry. For me, that nexus point was communication. It's like, okay, well, I've got a communication degree. I have a good understanding of storytelling. Let me see if I can help the space industry tell the story of this next chapter of spaceflight to their constituents. And that was the beginning of my career there. You could do the same thing through medicine, through law. Okay, let me figure out how can I untangle the legal frameworks for, you know, the first settlers on Mars? How can I apply telemedicine to allow humans to go further and further from planet Earth without a medical, you know, facility in reach? Any industry that you can think of, you can find a way to apply it to the next chapter.
Wow, that is some great advice. All right, Jude R. wants to know, how can space junk get removed from outer space?
It's a great question. This is actually a really timely discussion and it's becoming a problem. You know, it already is a problem, I should say. We have too much junk in space. And the problem is, you know, in the earlier days of space exploration where there wasn't as big of a capability to track the orbits of all of these pieces of debris. Now we have a problem where we are actively maneuvering the International Space Station or other spacecraft to get out of the line of, you know, impact with debris. And something as small as, I think 10 millimeters, don't quote me on this, but something incredibly small moving at that speed is capable of puncturing a window of the International Space Station. So we are talking tiny pieces of debris that can cause outsized damage. And so now more than ever, with more and more critical assets in orbit, think about all of the things that satellites power everything from your smartphones to our credit card banking systems, our GPS, everything we use every day is powered by these really sort of vulnerable type of assets orbiting overhead. And so space debris is actually a problem that I think the industry is moving towards looking proactively at solutions for, to make sure that not only can we track this debris, but how are we going to control and regulate the future of debris going forward from companies?
Oh, great. So man, we have our work cut out. We have to figure out how we're gonna get rid of a lot of the waste here on planet Earth and now some of the debris that we've created up in outer space. So
yeah,
a lot of work to do, which means a lot of job opportunities for you listeners and viewers of this show. All right, so again, this is The Color of Science brought to you by COSI and COSI Connects. My very special guest is Kellie Gerardi, aerospace entrepreneur, celebrity, defense, I mean, just, I mean, I would say Queen Bee, but Beyonce has that. So Queen Bee squared.
Let's go with that.
You know, so our pleasure to have you on board. This it's such a great conversation. I'm looking at David C's question here. David C wants to know what, and it's David, but listen to the question. He wants to know, what advice would you give to teenage girls who want to have a career in science? So I don't know, David, if you're a teacher or you're a parent of teenage girls, but what are your thoughts on that, Ms. Strong?
Yeah. I would give the similar advice. It's like, you know, anyone who wants a career in STEAM or STEM right now, I would still encourage to figure out, you know, what is the thing that just gets your heart rate moving when you think about, wow, I would love to do that one day, you know, and figure out what that thing is and then chase after it. And I think keep your mind open to the fact that there are more than one way to get to that outcome. You know, so for me, it was, you know, it's the dream of going to space, but my path was, and I fully intend to go in the next few years, which will be just the capstone to my personal dream and career. But it's not a linear path where, you know, everything I've ever done is just exactly building this totem pole to space, right? Instead, it's I'm gaining experience. I'm building up my credibility in this field. I'm getting new learning opportunities. I'm seeing different perspectives of the industry. I'm just sort of involving and immersing myself in this field that gets me excited. And through that, I create new opportunities for myself to get closer. In my case, it came with the suborbital research group and the opportunity to do some of this research myself in microgravity.
Very cool. Very cool. So that tees up the next question from Alex B. perfectly. Alex wants to know, how long will it take before civilians can experience spaceflight?
A couple months from now, actually.
We got to rewind that. This is a Color Science digital edition mic drop moment. Can you say this again? The question is,
absolutely.
How long can civilians go into space? And you said what?
A couple of months from now, we are going. So to backtrack first, we have already sent civilians to space, right? You know, folks have, been private astronauts on the International Space Station. But I think, you know, this year, what's really exciting is something called Inspiration 4, which is a mission that was just announced by SpaceX and Jared Isaacman, who is a billionaire entrepreneur who has purchased a Dragon spacecraft ride to orbit. So they'll spend about 3 days in space, and he's raising money for St. Jude's Children's Hospital by encouraging people to donate to St. Jude's. And he is taking three civilians with him on that flight later this year, who will be announced in the next 2 weeks. One of them is already announced. She was a childhood bone cancer survivor who now works with St. Jude's. Her name is Haley, and she will become the youngest American in space at the end of this year. And she is a civilian frontline healthcare worker who is going to space. And so this is it. It's the watershed moment. This is the beginning of the next chapter of spaceflight. And so I think there are already, you know, there's another initiative happening right now called Dear Moon, where a Japanese billionaire has purchased 8 seats to go on a lunar trip around the moon in orbit and aims to take 8 artists with him on that journey. And so these are all starting to come. The next decade is going to be full with more and more access points. And then, of course, we have the suborbital research platforms like a Virgin Galactic or like a Blue Origin, where we're going to see researchers, scientists, civilians like me, like you, able to access space.
Wow. Well, So it sounds like there are a lot of really wealthy people who are, you know, as you like to say, paying it forward and doing their part to raise funds for important things like cancer and whatnot. And they're funding missions to take civilians out. But I guess it still means it's pretty darn expensive. Can you share kind of what's your sense? I'm not going to hold you to this, but just in general, what's your sense? Because you mentioned it earlier in your intro remarks that the cost for space travel will drop. When we say drop, what would it cost Joe and Jane Public if they wanted to write a check to go up in space? Can they buy a seat? That's number one. And what would that cost, and how fast will that drop in the next 15, 20 years?
Yeah, absolutely. And so yes, to orbit or to an orbital destination or beyond, like the space station, you're looking at, you know, maybe let's ballpark $20 million to go. Okay. And so that's certainly not something that is immediately accessible. Is it possible? Yes. If you are, you know, if you have access to that capital and your dream is to go to space today, you can figure out a way to go. You can purchase a seat. You could do that. Suborbital platforms, instead of talking, you know, 10 or 20 million, we're talking a couple hundred thousand. And so that is already a step order of magnitude change in access to space. And what's happening there is you see like NASA flight opportunities where they previously just sent payload. They paid to send payloads to space with these platforms. Now they've started to put money down to send human-tended payloads and their researchers with the payloads on the space, because that is an accessible price point for academic institutions and government agencies to encourage the science. And so you're seeing this step order change come down, and the intent and the hope is that in the decades to come, as more and more operators come online, as competitive market prices help continue to bring down the cost of launch, that we are going to see an even greater price reduction and the ability to go.
Got it. Wow, this is great. So my last question that I'm going to read from the pre-submitted, then I'm going to go to the chat. This is from Cindy L. Cindy L wants to know, you're going to love this. Cindy L wants to know, should Pluto be a planet or not? And what's your take on that?
Yeah, this is the one time where I listen to my emotions instead of the science and say, yes, of course Pluto should still be a planet. It's, you know, my heart goes out to Pluto for the demotion to dwarf planet. If I had the power to reinstate the solar system the way I learned it growing up, Pluto would be back in top billing. So yeah, I love Pluto. So I wish that were the case.
All right, Neil deGrasse Tyson, beware. Kellie's coming after you.
I know. I got to call NASA and let them know.
You got it. All right, let me get to some of the questions on the chat. So this question is from Andrew H. What is a new project that you are interested in and hope to pursue soon?
So I would have to say my children's book series. So, you know, my first book was written sort of with adults or young adults in mind, people who were, you know, at the stage of looking at how to pursue the career of their dreams. And I was aiming to give a blueprint for that age group to look at. Instead, now I have the opportunity to reach really younger kids. This is a picture book series that'll be coming out at the end of the year. So my daughter, just for reference, Delta, she's 3. And so I'm aiming to reach that, you know, 4 to 8 year old range of really early exposure to space themes and the excitement about space through the vehicle of a children's book series. And so to me, that is the project that I'm currently just most excited about pursuing and building and seeing come to life.
That is so awesome. And when Delta V, when your daughter Delta V, I can't stop saying Delta V. When your daughter Delta V becomes an adult, she's gonna absolutely love the fact that you are writing those stories kind of with her in mind as she was becoming a girl into a woman. So that's just really cool. All right. Adam P wants to know, sorry, let me not skip this one. Tashia M wants to know, you are so inspiring. What do you want your legacy to be?
That's such a great question. You know, and it's hard because I'm just so focused on always like, how do I get to where I know I want to be, which in my case is in space. And so it's just this kind of, you know, taking a step back to think about, you know, let's all assume that I achieve that in the next few years, because I refuse to entertain any other possibility. And then, you know, after that point, what would I want the legacy to be? Again, I would look just on a smaller scale and, you know, look to the path of my daughter, like, what will it mean for my daughter to watch her mom launch to space? You know, what will it mean to know that you can do that? You can do it all, and you're able to follow your passions, knowing that, you know, it kept me away from her a lot, you know, in the last couple of years, whether it was parabolic flight campaigns or trainings. You know, I missed a lot of her firsts. I missed her first word, her first walking, you know, all of these like milestones I wasn't physically home for. But I want her to sort of grow up knowing that she should feel no guilt for following her dreams and for helping to invest in a future for the following generations where more and more people will have access.
Okay, great. I'm going to rip through these because I want to get to as many as possible. So Adam P wants to know, what could a spaceship do if it stopped because it ran out of fuel?
So this is a good question. I'm going to give my film degree disclaimer. But I will say that the majority of fuel that's used in a rocket is really to launch it from Earth, to like break the chains of gravity. That is where that fuel is used. In space and you know, in the environment where we're, you know, everything is weightless, right? Like zero gravity. The fuel is really used to make minor changes to, you know, the direction that the spacecraft is heading. It's not like, you know, that initial, like pumping the gas on the car. It's like, that's when you need to rev. It's leaving Earth. But it's a great question because for really long duration flights, we're going to start to think about how do we use fuel if we're manufacturing in space and if we're having ongoing activity in space. And I think in the future, you're going to start to hear of things like propellant depots in orbit. Kind of think of them as like orbital gas stations on the solar system highway. But I think we will have reserve stores of some of that precious fuel.
Terrific, terrific. So, all right. These are questions related back to when you talked about being mentored by Richard and Letitia. And then, of course, our great physicist, Stephen Hawking, says here, how did you feel when they were willing to take a chance on you?
Yeah, I mean, moved to tears, one. And then two, a little bit terrified, right? Because, that, you know, it's that pressure. It's like, wow, you know, their name is on the line for me. And so I need to make sure that I measure up to that. And so it was really, a great learning experience. I was so, so profoundly grateful that people would take a chance on me. And then I really doubled down my work ethic to make sure that that chance on me paid off and continued to pay dividends back to them.
Great, great. Here's a question from Mandy. Mandy Simon wants to know, is there water in space?
Yep, definitely. Water is a really, I was almost going to say it's an abundant resource in space, but that's not without some really important nuance because water is still very difficult to extract from space. But if you take the moon or Mars, for example, when you have these icy regions or areas where you could extract water from to create it from its constituent ingredients, so it's accessible, right? But at the same time, it is an incredibly precious resource. And so, you know, in my experience at the Mars Desert Research Station, for example, when we were living in a simulation of what it would be like to be early settlers on Mars, water was the most precious resource. It was something that was, you know, technically renewable in the sense that we could take apart its constituent ingredients and be able to, you know, create it, but not without a lot of effort. And obviously this is something that was the most restricted of our supplies. And so showers, you know, those were baby wipes. Those weren't faucets, you know, things like that. Field latrines instead of like flush toilets. I mean, we're talking real water conservation because you need it for basic everyday things like food. You can't bring fresh food. So everything is freeze dried, basically. You need water to reconstitute it, to make it edible again from that form. And so, you know, you're using water for the absolute most necessities versus, and I will say that my biggest takeaway when I came back to Earth from the Mars Desert Research Station was recognition to the degree to which I waste water on a daily, and we all do. I mean, I now look at things like my laundry load, my dishwasher, you know, my husband and I often butt heads because I ensure that the dishwasher is 1000% over full before I'm running it, you know, even to the detriment of, you know, actually functioning. But it's something I now really look at closely.
Got it. Great. So we have Patricia Vasquez wants to know, if you had a brand, what would you have on your brand?
Yeah, so I have in the past started a brand. I actually had a space fashion brand a few years ago.
You're clearly wearing a space shirt, so.
Yeah, exactly. So fashion is something I really love. I think in an alternate dream career, I would have been a fashion designer. And so I did attempt to start a space fashion line. It was such a great learning experience. It was also a giant money pit. So I don't know if I can really recommend it. I think the Venn diagram of people who like are obsessed with space and fashion is still a little too small to like warrant the big brand, but we're going to get there. But my brand at the time was called Paper Rocket. And it was kind of a whimsical little paper airplane turned rocket that had a little trailing dotted line. And the idea was that, you know, space should be fun. It should be accessible. It's whimsical. It's rooted in our, you know, human imagination and ingenuity. And so my brand was called Paper Rocket.
That is awesome. Remember that, folks, Paper Rocket, look it out. All right. And another question. When you go to space, what is something interesting you would want to find in space?
Yeah. So, you know, for me, look, and to answer the question right on the head, it's like where I think this is getting at is maybe one of, you know, humanity's most existential questions, like, are we alone? What else is out there? Right. And those are really valid questions. the truth is that no one can say for sure right now, which is kind of an exciting premise, right? It's like kind of scary either way. If the answer is we are alone or we're not, in either way, it's like profound. And so for me, while I wouldn't personally be looking for signs of life on the flights that I was doing, I would be conducting research in microgravity. What I'm excited about currently with space exploration is, think about Perseverance rover, who just recently landed on Mars, a planet entirely inhabited by robots right now. But Perseverance is really exciting insofar as that rover is roving around Mars, specifically looking for signs of ancient microbial life, to understand what was the, you know, state of Mars back before, you know, its current thin atmosphere today, perhaps when it was a warmer, wetter, moister planet. It's also carrying a helicopter. Ingenuity is the name of the helicopter that will perform the first powered flight on another planet. And so while Perseverance roves around looking for signs of ancient life and taking soil samples and rock samples, Ingenuity will be flying overhead, scouting out scientifically interesting destinations to go to. And so I think more than ever before, we have this tool chest of really powerful ways to investigate the environment around us, our solar neighborhood, so to speak. And I think I am just so hopeful that in my lifetime, we get at least a hint of answers to some of these giant questions that have inspired explorers from, you know, the dawn of humanity.
That is fantastic. It is getting close to the end of our time, so I have time for maybe two more questions. You're listening to The Color of Science. I'm Frederick Burley, President and CEO of COSI. My very special guest is Kellie Gerardi, space extraordinaire. I keep shortening your title because it's just, she's Miss Space. That's where we're going with that. Question from Hannah H. here. Do you have any insider info about working on the Mars Desert Research Station that most people don't know about?
Yeah. I think this kind of goes back to crew selection that we were talking about. You know, obviously, aside from all of the technical, you know, issues that early settlers will have to face on Mars, and we did it all right. We simulated total loss of power, total loss of fuel, total loss of communications, cut off with Earth, like just catastrophic losses to simulate what would be par for the course in an environment designed to kill you. And so we did the same, you know, losing our toilet, our refrigerator, our water pump. We transformed a rover outside, which was an ATV, but it was our rover, into a temporary power generator, you know, and we did it all in spacesuits to top it off. But I think what I took away beyond that was the degree to which collaboration and partnership and communication was so incredibly important in a team who is going to be living in isolation together for a long duration of time in a very small shared living and working space. I mean, we're talking like what anyone would consider a small one-bedroom apartment sized facility with seven adults living and working and sleeping and eating full-time and doing research. And so it really is not glamorous. And so I think it just showed me that in the future, it's like, okay, if the steely-eyed sort of fighter pilot profile was the right candidate for like a high octane orbit around the Earth, who is the right candidate to make a home out of a hostile environment, you know, like Mars? Like we are talking emotional fortitude, like a different type of psychological resilience. It's a different profile set, and things that I look forward to seeing how those profiles develop.
Yeah, wow. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been a fantastic program. I'm sorry to say we are very near the end. I just have to do a few plugs and close out. It has been incredible to have you on The Color of Science Digital Edition with COSI Connects. Thank you, Mr. Gerardi. You're an inspiration to people of all ages. Absolutely best of luck on your next book series. Folks, check her out on social media. Definitely buy her book if you've not bought it yet. And if you want to buy it and get it signed copy, the easiest way is to go to Gramercy Books. And definitely, we all look forward to your children's book series. I know it's going to be a bestseller, New York Times list. I can't wait to see it. And with that, I just want to thank you so much for sharing your time with us. I do want you to stick around, though, because we're going to announce the challenge, which is a really cool art for this whole STEAM thing. We have an art competition associated with that. First, though, I do want to put a plug in for COSI. This is our COSI Connects kit. It is a box with five hands-on experiences, and this one is the space edition. So everything you wanted to know about how to go to space that, that you already heard, of course, from Mr. Gerardi, but feel free to go to cosi.org and pick up one of those kits. With that, let me share my screen to talk about the art contest that's inspired by today's very special guest. Here we go. So the STEAM Challenge, it's our March art contest theme, and the theme is science communication or space goals. So you can do your art inspired by science communication or space goals. It can be a drawing, a painting, 2D, 3D, whatever art inspired product you want to do, please do that. Send it to VanessaBowers@cosi.org. Again, that's VBowers@cosi.org. Easiest thing, pull out your cell phone, snap a picture here. And we got three prizes we give away. Third place, you get a Cosi Connects kit. We'll be giving away the space kit that I just showed you. Second place, you'll get a cool hologram machine. I'm telling you, this. I saw Kelly look up when she heard that. She's like, wait a minute, that's a pretty cool gift. A cool hologram machine. And the first place winner gets an iPad mini. We do those draws twice a year, every 6 months. So we'll be drawing our first one by the end of April, actually, since we started in November. Definitely submit your piece here. And stay tuned for next week. And this is next month's guest. It's so amazing that we had Mr. Gerardi here, because one of the things that I love that you said, Kelly, was, hey, you know, you're a gifted person, bright, brilliant, pursuing STEM, STEAM careers, working with space and space flight and all this cool stuff, but you're also into fashion. You're also into beauty. You mentioned makeup, and that's a great segue to our next guest, April 1st. Yes, I know it's April Fool's, but this is not a joke. Our next guest, and we had to dig deep to follow up Mr. Art. Our next guest is none other than Camille Schrier. For those of you who don't know her, that is Miss America 2020. She'll be coming to COSI. Why? Because not only is she Miss America, which is kind of cool, but even more exciting to COSI, she's a nerd like all of us. She is a biochemist. Yes, Miss America, just like Mr. Gerardi, has straddled that fashion, beauty kind of space, as well as STEM, STEAM, and careers in science, technology, engineering, and math. So with that, definitely check us out. That is April 1st, the Thursday, 12 to 1 p.m., definitely check that out. And then lastly, as you know, we've got a show called QED with Dr. B. This is a PBS WCU collaboration with COSI. It is 7:30 once a week on Thursdays. It's a primetime cool science and engineering geeky show. Definitely check that out. And I got to come back to you with Mr. Gerardi about this program, but I'll talk to you about that offline. With that, I just wanted to say thank you again to Jordan Radar from COSI Connects Live and Vanessa Bowers from The Color of Science to help make this program come alive. Most importantly, thank all of you guests for listening to our amazing, incredible, and I want to say this actually, unparalleled Kellie Gerardi, because there are other astronauts, but you're one of a kind, and you're really, no pun intended, trailblazing, really being a wonderful role model, not just for girls, a wonderful role model for men, women, and all of us on this planet. So thank you so much for sharing your time with us. You've been an inspiration. I'm Frederick Bird. This is Color Science. I want to give you the last word, Mr. Gerardi.
Oh, that's so kind of you. I am humbled to be here today. I'm so grateful for the fascinating discussion, all of your kind questions. And, you know, my parting words would be, I am accessible. Yes, I have a couple hundred thousand followers on social media, but I think, you know, the reason that people have stuck with me for that journey is I make myself accessible. I try to answer every single direct message that I get. It may take me a few weeks, but I have never not answered someone when they reached out to me. And so please do take me up on it if there's something that I can help you with.
Wow, that's a true gift. Thank you so much for that selflessness. Ladies and gentlemen, COSI Connects Live presents you The Color of Science from COSI. Miss Kellie Gerardi, follow her, check her out. She's an inspiration. Take care, everyone, and I'll see you on April 1st with Miss America. Bye for now.